and welcome to this brand new episode of Youthquake. In this journey that we've had in this series, when we're trying to understand young MPs a little bit more, today our guest is not that young and, well, not that inexperienced as well. He's somebody who's very well versed with the corridors of power, and it's not ironic then that we can actually see South Lock right behind you there. Gaurav, welcome to Youthquake.
Thanks, Sonal. Very
nice I must to have say, you. Thank you, and I must say that all the MPs that I've interviewed so far, you're the oldest.
Great.
At 36, you're the oldest. How does that make you feel, and what does it say about the current Lok Sabha?
Well, you see, in Indian politics, you feel like as if you're young till you're 55. So the fact that you're calling me old at 36, I think it's mind-boggling. It'll take for a while for me to settle this.
Yeah, but this is your second term as a parliamentarian, right? And in parliament currently, when you see so many 26, 27, 28-year-olds who are in their second terms, some even very, very new, not from political lineages like yours, make their way, how does that what is the sense that you're getting in parliament right now?
No, I'm quite optimistic because when you hear these parliamentarians raise the issues in parliament, no, they're talking everything from artificial intelligence to a railway bridge that isn't required in the constituency.
Yes.
So it shows tremendous connect with the grassroots, but at the same time, their vision, their way of thinking and articulating is so progressive that I feel very good about my country and very good about the way democracy is shaping.
And do you think it's, how is it for young politicians in the country at the moment when the grand old parties are really, you know, dominating? This election could have been one where a lot of regional parties could have played a role. That did not happen. Big national parties have come back to power in big ways. What does it say about, you know, how they are placed within their organization?
Are you talking about young politicians?
Yes.
I think it's absolutely the best time for young politicians because they are willing willing to take a risk. They'll be willing to push the boundaries a bit. They'll be willing to be themselves because they know that they have nothing to lose. And this is the time to really make their mark. And I had it been a very conventional electoral result where two big grand old parties got massive numbers, then the young voices would have been crowded out by the seniors of their respective parties. But now they feel
that's like not the case, you think, anymore.
That's not the case because you really have to really find ways of articulating your party's vision in a new way.
Yeah.
If you have to connect with young people, you also have to step up to the plate and take the roles that normally your seniors would have.
But how is it like being a young leader in an old party?
I think it's very exciting because in my personal experience has been that I've been very empowered. That in my first term last year, I was made in charge of an important state like West Bengal, important union territory like Andaman, been given tremendous responsibility. And every time I've been backed, I've taken some major decisions in my role as AICC in charge or been part of screening committees. And the fact that I've been backed and that my voice is respected and my decision and my political insight, though it might be limited, is respected, I think it gives tremendous confidence and it's given me a tremendous boost.
So let's go back to the time when you were here in Delhi. Tell us, where did you go to school? How did that happen? And you didn't always want to be a politician, is that correct?
Well, coincidentally, I went to school not far from here, St. Columbus, which is just around here.
Okay.
And
so this is home. Delhi is home for you.
I'm very comfortable in Delhi, but I'm very confident that my identity is not a Delhiite. Even when I was very young, people would say that to me. They said, well, you're born in Delhi, you've grown up in Delhi, so you're a Delhiite. I said, no, at heart, I'm an Assamese. I'm just living in Delhi.
Being an Assamese, isn't that more of a responsibility now on you? Because you've not lived there, but you feel that since you are so close to power and your proximity to the leaders who matter and who can build a change, then it becomes like a necessity to talk about it, right? It can't be an identity.
Well, growing up, it was an identity. And now in my role, for me, actually, I don't even look at Assam. I look at the entire Northeast. That I am representing the Northeast of our country in this parliament. Because traditionally, Northeast politicians in the past, maybe because of circumstances of that time, just did not have the time to really articulate the concerns of their respective regions. And Northeast again seems to be, you know, far from Delhi. So far from here, out of sight, out of mind. So for me, it's very important that I stand up for not only my constituency, my state, but right. I also stand up for my region.
Hmm.
You know, I stand up for issues that Naga students are facing here, or Manipuri students might be facing in Bangalore. And I talk about...
And there's a lot of them here in the national capital.
Absolutely.
But let's just go back to where we were. So schooling was at?
Schooling, St. Columbus.
Yeah, just around here.
I was a typical, young boy of that age where we thought, you know, you study science, you go for engineering, you go for MBA, and your degree is set. I was very much interested in liberal arts and history and civics, but my school did not have the options of liberal arts. So I was going down a very well-trodden path, got a job in Bombay, moved there, rising up, Airtel, taking the local Mumbai train, having, you know, cutting chai and bananas at one, vada pav was my breakfast. I was loving it.
Yeah.
Because anybody who's been from Delhi and lived in... or worked in Bombay, knows the difference in cultures and really enjoys that.
Yeah.
And suddenly a bug bit me one day, and I think it was just making friends from the non-profit sector, NGO sector. And I felt so shallow that here I am just talking about, you know, my company profits or my personal growth. And here are these amazing individuals that I was getting to meet at that point of time. And they were working with underprivileged children. They were going to remote areas. Some of them were Indian. Some of them were foreigners working in India. And that really, I think, lit a spark in me. And I said, like, listen, what?
You got to do more.
I got to do public service. So I left my job. That's been one of my best decisions. Because the work that I did after the corporate sector, in the non-profit sector, helped me travel to, you know, villages, helped me travel to states of India that I'd never been to. So right from Pokhran, Falodi in Rajasthan to Gair Sen and Anjani Sen in Uttarakhand. And it just gave me, you know, I met some fantastic leaders and grassroots leaders. I met from the Chipko Andolan, I met from the Teri Dama Andolan. So I met these like Sundarlal Bahugana.
And you were just meeting them as part of
As part of my work, yeah.
Okay.
Part of my work at that point, a major part of my work was taking students from Sanskriti school,
yeah,
a program,
huh,
taking students from Sanskriti school
huh
to these villages,
wow,
and making them live there for 10 days.
That's
while
lovely
interacting with the local NGOs and grassroots organizations.
And then?
And then, once I continued, I said like...
There has to be purpose.
There has to be purpose also. Then I understood the concept
impact
of power.
Yeah.
Power also. Because every NGO... In the end, if they want to get a major policy decision done, they have to go to the bureaucrat or the politician.
Correct.
Right? So while I understood scale, I understood impact, I also understood about power. And I understood that if you want to, you know, reach the corridors of power, you have to get into politics. And I've seen in my state of Assam, in Northeast as well, that if politics played right, can even contribute to peace and harmony. As I said, growing up as...
Democracy, dialogue, working with young people, I saw how a state changes. So did you just walk up to your father and said that, okay, I want to contest?
My father was very hands-off with me because up till 2011, I had never gone campaigning with him, never showed any interest in politics.
What are you saying? Never growing up?
Never. Never. I was just not interested.
And your father was chief minister in that period.
I must say, I also associated at that time politics with being away from your family.
Yeah.
So my going up from childhood.
I understand.
So for me, and it's something to do with elections.
Yeah.
Something to do with rhetoric. For me, non-profit was a much more direct way of working with people without elections or any of the backstabbing that happens in a political party, right? Like you work in an organization, you're all on the same page.
Were you
page
almost angry with your father for being a politician growing up?
No, in fact, now that I'm in the same boat, I'm a new parent. I have a son who's 2.5 years, 3 years old. So I am making very conscious decision that I have to be a father, be a husband, as well as be a representative.
Is that even possible?
Well, I take inspiration from women, and especially Indian women, because they are multitasking.
See, this is what you get. When you're an experienced politician, you always have the right answers. So we'll give that to Gaurav Gogoi at the moment.
Right us. I think, look at everyone. They're MPs in parliament, right?
Yes.
My contemporaries in parliament, my peers in parliament, and they're balancing everything, right? So I'm very, I think one of the things that have happened in the last 20 years is that Indian women have really empowered. They've been CEOs, they've been politicians, chief ministers.
And I think it's very necessary for in today's time that Indian men also take on a lot more household responsibilities. Indian men also know that it's easy, it's okay if you let go of power and you share power. It's fine to take instructions from
Thumbs up from me for saying all of that, and you've definitely got all the women, you know, gushing for you. Having said that, but talking about parenthood, you met your wife in a very unconventional way and you were away. What happened then? Tell us.
So, I've actually never talked about this on TV before, so this is my first time. So, congratulations for bringing this out. It's something I keep private, but I was doing my master's in the US, and post my master's I happened to meet my wife, who is also from the UK, and her interests are in climate change, politics, economy.
Wow.
And we met, and we eventually embarked upon a long distance relationship. And
you were, what were you doing in US at that time?
I had completed my master's in non-profit management public policy, so I was doing a small projects with Amnesty International or international non-profits, United Nations. Just trying to like build a career in the non-profit world. And she happened to be there, was also doing her internship. We met, everything clicked. What followed was a 4 years of long distance relationship.
Yeah.
Very difficult.
At a time when telecom rates weren't that cheap and Skype.
Thank God Skype for
calls,
Skype.
Yeah, and WhatsApp.
But there was no WhatsApp.
There was no WhatsApp. There was no FaceTime either.
There was no
FaceTime. Yeah.
And we were in different, and I left US, so we were in different time zones.
Yeah.
So it was nice. I think that also led to how we making a marriage work, because we were just not used to being under the same roof.
That set the tone.
So if we cracked that, then this was easy.
Yeah.
And then I remember before getting married, many people who were concerned within my family and friends, they were saying like, listen, you're running for election in 2014. Do you want to get married? Do you want to marry a foreigner? What will be the reaction? And I thought like that is just so wrong. Like I can't go to my voter without being completely honest about who I am and bringing myself and being transparent, right? And
I was saying there was no backlash of the fact that A, she was not just a non-Assamese, she was not an Indian. There was
no actually, because you know, if you meet her, she's one of the most lovable people, very accommodating.
Yeah, but a lot of people don't even get that chance, is what I'm trying to say.
So actually, she actually came on the, so I said, listen, if you're telling me I was a bit of a rebel, if you're telling me to get married after elections, I'm going to get married before elections, and I'm going to take her to campaign with me in the constituency.
Wow.
So we got married in November 2013, April.
No, but hang on. How did family take it? Was your father okay with it?
Right? As I said, if you meet my father, he's 83 right now, but at heart he's like 21. You know, he's younger than I am.
So it was quite easy. You said, I'm going to prove a point, I'm going to get married before election, and you took her around on your campaigning.
Yeah,
first election, 2014, right?
2014, married 6 months earlier. She wore an Assamese mekhla sador, moved around, learned a few words in Assamese, and actually, she became even more popular in the constituency than me, because people in the constituency had seen me for
this
the last 3 years.
This sounds like a fairy tale. It does not happen.
I've been very lucky.
Think at 36, then you've got pretty much everything going for you. You have
Except my party is not in power. That's the only thing that we'll have to.
Let's talk about that. Let's talk about that then. What do you have to say about Rahul Gandhi not taking up the presidentship?
I think that's a great sign of being responsible and being accountable. He was clearly the face of the campaign, the leader of the campaign, and in the end, he took a decision.
But where does this leave the party? Where does it leave people like
you? That's something for us to find out collectively.
If you were to pick one, who would you choose?
I'm not going to pick one, because I feel like let there be a discussion, let there be a committee meeting, let our senior leaders come together, let's have the discussion, because so far we've been avoiding the discussion as well, because really it's, you know, till the time Rahul Gandhiji's official letter has come out today, people were still believing that they could change his mind. And now we really, the onus is on us. And I think irrespective
But there's a lot of debate, and to just sum it up in one line, it's this. Can the Congress party survive without the Gandhis at the helm of affairs? We've seen that in the past.
That's what I was going
to say. It did not work out. So what is it that you guys are dreaming of at the moment?
That's what I was going to say. Just because Rahul Gandhi is not the party president does not mean that he's no longer a congressman. does not mean that he's not going to be fighting and advocating for the values of Congress. Does not mean that he's going to go out to the various state elections that are happening this year in Jharkhand, Haryana, and not talking about what Congress governments are doing in Punjab. So it's a new role for Rahul Gandhi in the Congress party, and I think we have to accept that, respect his decision as much as we want to oppose it, but we must respect it. And then, you know, in his new role.
Are you, as a young congressman, excited about this shift that's happening in the Congress party? Like, this is something not a lot of people would have dreamt of, right? Are you excited to be part of this? And if you were, like, you've dreamed of everything and you've got it, if you were to dream of something for Congress party in, say, 5 years from now, what would that be?
Well, two things. A, it is unprecedented that our party is in a very difficult position. It's also unprecedented that a party president like Rahul Gandhi is stepping down. I mean, for
is
someone,
it really? I mean,
well,
come
for
on.
Someone like my father, right, who's been through generations of Congress, to see, it's a very emotional moment. And you got to understand Congress sometimes. You know, it's not a very organized card. It's a family, right? So it's an unprecedented moment. But at the same time, when the second part of the question, it's, I think, in every crisis comes opportunity. Every time we lose, we learn. And I think we learned a lot from 2014. Still didn't get the results we wanted in 2019. But this is going to be a tremendous amount of learning. And it's really for Congress to fall in sync with Indian youth. And if we, within our ethos of, secularism, plurality, social welfare, economic growth, if we are able to reinvent ourselves.
What is it that Congress will be doing now which is different from what they did in the previous session?
Well, I can't say right now because we have to get a new structure in place. But I really hope that what people are saying, that Congress is following this soft Hindutva line. And I think that is something that is, that we're not doing, but also something that we need more clarity on. Because if you
internally see, you mean?
In articulating it,
yes,
we might
yes.
have that clarity internally, but in terms of our articulation is not coming out. Because I feel that what people of India need to see is a clear difference between Hindustan and Hindutva. They have to see what Hindustani means and what does the slogans that were being talked about by the BJP.
Okay, I have one more question and then we'll not discuss Congress party. And I don't want that to hog the entire, you know, interview today. So, you know, I meet young MPs from different political parties, from Shiv Sena, from BJP, etc. It's so interesting that a lot of them come from lineage, from dynasty, but they're not always from the same political party. A lot of them I meet have had their grandfathers or their fathers in Congress or in other political parties. And now the kids just don't want to join the Congress anymore. They're saying, well, the future is with the BJP and they idolize Prime Minister Modi and they want to be there. Is that worrying on where the future of Congress lies? Perhaps young people like you, if there is a young Gaurav Gogoi in somebody else's family today, is saying, well, I don't want to go to Congress anymore. They're switching and going to other political parties.
I think it's disappointing if you're joining politics as a way of improving your personal career. That should not be the way. Politics.
No, but when they join, they really feel that, you know, Prime Minister Modi is the way forward. They idolize him.
You see, I think that's a very wrong way of approaching it. Because
what do you feel of Prime Minister Modi?
First of all, what I feel about politics is a way of shaping the world and shaping society. And I am happy with the way Indian society is moving forward. And there are some questions and some concerns that I have. So irrespective of whether my party is in power or not, the principles that I hold dear, the values that I hold dear, I'm going to fight for that. Even if Congress party is reduced to one person, I believe in the values of Congress.
That's a very idealistic speech. Let me just call a spade. Like it's a very idealistic speech. But okay, coming back to
Let me challenge you a bit. You see what's happening in Hong Kong, right? You see people coming out on the streets of Hong Kong talking about democracy. Remember the Arab Spring. People were used to 30 years of one leader, one party ruling, and they came out on the streets.
But Gaurav, so people in this country are revolting and the youngsters are against the Congress party. The same values that you want to uphold, these people on streets, in cafes, in Delhi University, sitting everywhere, are mocking Rahul Gandhi, and that's a fact. right?
So I think,
and they, all of them are very sold to the BJP idea, and they all believe in Prime Minister's agenda. Correct. So you are not on the bright side of Adam Springer.
So let me see. Let me answer the next question, the one of the earlier questions that you asked. That what do I think of Prime Minister Modi? And I think Prime Minister Modi is a great communicator, a great orator, and a great marketer. Hmm. And people are really, you know, are connecting with him.
Hmm.
That doesn't make me wrong. That makes me say that, okay, what do I need to do in order to connect with people? And I think that's the most important thing for my party right now, is that we got to build bridges with young people. We got to build bridges with people across all geographies, all states, and we must come up with a new message.
I think I keep hearing what is to be done, but not so much of how it is to be done. I think that's what's missing. But all right, so we have a challenge on Youthquake in this series that we do a rapid fire with young MPs. I say one thing, and you have to say very quickly the one thing that comes to your mind about it. They're basically issues that you have to tell me about.
Sure.
Okay, we begin with, what are your thoughts on social media?
Great, fantastic, and dangerous.
What are your thoughts on trolls?
Trolls helps you develop a thick skin.
Gay marriages, same-sex marriages.
It's personal choice. Personal choice needs to be celebrated.
Marital rape
needs to be banned, needs to be outlawed. Much stricter laws required.
Reservation
is a way of, you know, over, there's past injustice that we still have to be accountable for.
What about women reservation in parliament?
Women reservation, women empowerment, I'm all for you know, reservation in any form of empowerment. And if women want reservation, they should have it.
Sabri,
if they don't
Mala.
Want reservation, they want some other form of empowerment, that's fine.
Sabrimala.
It's a matter of religious faith. And I think while constitution exists, Supreme Court exists, you have to understand that India is a deeply religious country.
In one word, Rahul Gandhi, define him.
He is a new leader, a modern leader.
He's not new, Gaurav. He's been here for so long.
I think the ideas of politics that he represents are very contemporary.
Okay, okay. Since I said I'll stick to one word. One word in which you want to define Rahul Gandhi. One more chance, I'll give
you. As I said, he's very new, very modern.
Okay. Prime Minister Modi.
Great marketer, great orator.
Amit Shah.
Strategist.
Your father.
A gentleman.
And Gaurav Gogoi.
Still discovering himself.
All right, on that note, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks.
This has been lovely. So that was Gaurav Gogoi, and absolutely uncensored for you. We got to know a lot about him, not just politics, but other aspects as well. If you like a program, you can write to us at myyouthquake@ndtv.com. And like we always say, if you're young, restless, have an opinion, come right up, and we've got the platform for you. For now, thanks for watching. Bye-bye.